afternoon as we gather together with the presence of loved ones around you, with you, and in the presence of the God who's poured life into each one of us. And so we've come to celebrate the life of Leighton Burkhart. When we gather together in moments like this, I want to remind us that you are not only here with the ones that you've been talking with and sharing with and remembering with, but that we truly are here in the presence of the unseen one, the God who has given us life, and the God who, by faith in his Son, Jesus Christ, calls us back into his very presence. That's the kind of powerful, loving, amazing relationship that God wants to have with us and that we can celebrate in moments of loss, of grief, and of sorrow. That kind of hope can be yours, can be ours. A long time ago, a writer of scripture wrote these words down and called the 23rd Psalm, and many of us have heard it before. I invite you to hear these words in this moment, in this context, as words of amazing hope. The psalmist writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Would you join me in a moment of prayer? Let's pray again. Heavenly Father, you are the one. You are the one who hears our every prayer. And in you alone we find rest, we find hope, we find life, not only upon this earth, but that life which you have called us to live into and to experience that lasts forever and ever. So God, we come to you in these moments, trusting you to be powerfully present, that we might honor you as we remember and celebrate the life that you gave to Leighton. We praise you, God, for the heritage that you shape in the world of people around us, family and friends, community, people we work with, all of those people, Lord, that Leighton's life touched. We celebrate those relationships as we live and love in these moments that you give to us. Lord, help this gathering of family and friends, I'm sure many others in other places today who are remembering Leighton as we meet here. Help us, Lord, to grieve with hope as we remember and celebrate our lives together, as this family and circle of friends remembers their lives together with Leighton. May this time together give glory to you, God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May what we do here today help us to remember and celebrate your greatness as we acknowledge the mystery of both life and of death. May we be content with you and in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, when those and Terry were sharing with me for a few minutes, sometime in the last couple of days, I'm losing track of time just like you are, I'm sure. Began to hear a little bit about Leighton's life, these two verses came to mind. The psalmist, another writer of the Psalms, wrote these words. "I will lift up," you know where I'm going yet, some of you? "I will lift up my eyes to the mountains, from whence shall my help come?" And then the answer follows, "My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." It's an invitation for us to look up, look into the heavens, look to the Creator, the one who is always calling us forward, upward, onward, calling us home.
It's down there.
Of a song. A song that gives us, I think, another invitation through another medium, a way for us to find hope and peace at the time of death and of loss. I hope that there's more to life than what we see and what we experience here. God's plan for this world is often filled with mystery. I doubt that I get much of a disagreement from all of you who gathered here. Life is filled with mystery. I invite you to listen to a writer of Scripture, a writer from the New Testament of our Bible. It's from the book of Revelation. And this is a person trying to use words that we understand to describe something that's indescribable. Revelation 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no more mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." Thanks be to God. let us remember and celebrate Layton's life upon this earth, with that being one of the pictures, one of the invitations of how we find hope, knowing that what we see and experience here is not all that there is, with all the joy and all the difficulties, all the blessings and all the heartaches of life, that we have hope as those who believe that we're all being called to a higher place when we leave this earth. So we remember together that Layton Lynn Burkhart was born on July 8th, 1936 in Ogden, son of David and Ada Johnson Burkhart. He graduated from Ogden High School in 1954, and on October the 27th, 1954, Layton was united in marriage to his high school sweetheart, Phyllis Darlene Carter, in Ogden. He farmed in Ogden and then moved to Ames, the Ames area, to work as an electrician. And Layton finished his career retiring from Iowa State University. Terry, would you like to come and share some more memories and stories from your family?
When we lose someone we love, the immediate sense of loss is its heartbreaking and overwhelming. And the meaning of an accident takes on a new significance. Normally our reaction to a mishap is, it's just an accident. Most of us have these in a daily basis. We don't really put much significance to them. Then the worst happens and the results are ugly, and we can't understand why it happened. At the same time, it seems a new clarity emerges about living. Specifically, a clarity about what family means and how deep their reflector of the connection really is. Dad's focus has always been family comes first. It's a solid base that allows us to grow strong. And Dad and Mom did a good job giving it to us. They worked as a team, and trust me, they were solid and did well as a team. It started when Dad met a little tiny girl, a 98-pound girl named Phyllis. And that was it for Dad. And that started a marriage that would last 61-plus years. She stole his heart, and he never looked back. As an adult, I came to appreciate the bond. I have to be honest, as a teen, it was super frustrating. And believe me, it ran poorly, and I used it by turns testing the bond. And we might have scratched it, but all they had to do was look at each other, and they were on the same page, and we were toast. When we talked, you listened, and if you were lucky enough, or maybe I should say if we were smart enough, we learned a little bit. He had a wealth of knowledge and could make anything out of nothing at all. Beautiful things. Some examples on the tables. Or they were things that he just used on a daily basis. If he came across something that would make life easier, he made it. It was done. He worked every day of his life because that is what he loved to do. That's what men do. Great men. He always saw the potential. We all know that for years Dad has dealt with severe pain every day, but he never showed it. He always remained thankful for everything he had. And his positive can-do attitude was one of his greatest strengths. As we, his family and friends, as we work through our loss, the memories are going to make us laugh and cry, and that's okay. We need that. It shows the impact he has had on each of us and how he helped us in his unassuming way to be better people. Dad never had a negative word to say about anybody. His motto was, if you don't have anything nice to say, keep your mouth shut. And I've been hearing a lot of good comments about him. He's the person I measure every guy against. I hope I can be 1/10 of the man he was. And my personal is not really, he never, ever, ever left the dinner table without giving Mom a kiss and a hug and saying thank you, or whatever she might have fed him. Didn't matter. And when I hear comments like this, I realize again why he's always been my hero. And as we help each other get through this loss, we just need to remember there's no better legacy that a person can help to leave. To me, it's a testament to a man we've all been lucky to have and we had in our lives. So.
First, or the next few words that I put down in my notes kind of reflects, I know more why it reflects the song that you chose to have played a moment ago, and some of what you shared with me a couple of days ago, and Terry, as you began to talk about your father and the pain that he endured over the years. I don't know what all of that means, you all do, or at least many of you do, and just really a powerful thing to hear what you said, not only now, but what you told me when it was just the three of us talking, that that pain didn't keep lateness. I'm sure all of you know it at one level or another. Didn't keep you from living life to its fullest, pressing ahead, pressing on, enjoying life, sharing life with others. And you know, I thought this might be a good spot for me to sort of wedge in here that maybe just a little bit where that came from was what you also told me the two of you did sometime in life, which was teach Sunday school together. You know, I'm a pastor, so I'm going to say I'm guessing that some of that ability of strength, that character, might have come from some of what he was teaching and living and sharing in those moments, which is always a powerful thing for us to hear as well. Where does the strength come from? Where does the hope come from to press on, especially through times that are painful and challenging, which it sounds like he did in a very passionate, hopeful, powerful way. He earned the respect of those around him, you told me. He was a good listener, and others listened to him. As a boss, Layton was someone who could be strict when necessary. I'm always tempted to stop at a moment like that and say, could I have a show of hands for those that, you know, but probably wouldn't be best. Could be strict when necessary, but was also fair. Didn't speak unfairly of others, as Kevin mentioned. It was just a, and I thought this was pretty neat, said to me, just a solid, solid person. A family man, apparently part of what that meant was that he didn't go out partying a lot. Unless you count square dancing as partying. And then you did a lot of that. I think it's okay to say that you guys party. Square dance. You could tell Layton grew up on a farm. He mentioned that a fix-it guy. He enjoyed woodworking, avid outdoorsman in about every way possible, from hunting to fishing to landscaping to gardening to the lapidary. It would just be, I'm sure, a part of, it has been a part of your conversations and will be, which parts of those parts of his lives each of you have connected with him in, and how those parts of your life that will continue will be ways that you remember and continue to celebrate your lives together with him. You mentioned that a lot of rocks have been hauled over the years. And I thought it was pretty amazing, if I got this right, when you were sharing, pretty amazing that when kids would come for trick-or-treat night, they would actually want some of his creations, those rocks, more than candy. And then you told me the story about where maybe some of his creativity was recognized very early on in life. The 5-year-old friend isn't here, is that right? No, okay. Well, I think it's okay. But apparently, Layton and a 5-year-old friend, when they were 5 years old, found a cigarette rolling device, and they would be very perceptive as to who was tossing away their used cigarettes, gather up the butts of those cigarettes and harvest the tobacco out of them and put them in some tins that they were keeping. And then when they had enough, they'd roll their own cigarettes. Until they were caught. That's the way the story goes. And so I put that under the category of early on creativity. Keep telling stories. Keep remembering. Laughing. Crying. letting how your lives were, how your lives intersected each other through weeks, years, decades, to let all of that continue to be what you remember and celebrate in the years ahead. For in these moments, we remember that Leighton Burkhart was 80 when he passed away on Thursday, August the 11th. Leighton was preceded in death by his parents, a brother, Dennis, and a great-grandson. He is survived by his wife of 61 years, Phyllis, a son, Raven, two daughters, Terry Hoff, Mike McDonald, and Coralie Muhammad Hamzi, 10 grandchildren, 22 great-grandchildren, and two great-great-grandchildren, and one sister, Nyla Good. You know, a funeral service or a memorial service in some ways is a very, very unique moment when we acknowledge and grieve the death of a loved one while at the same time celebrating life. We remember the life of the one who has died, and yet we celebrate our lives together as we look back and we have the opportunity to reflect on, I think maybe as Terry just mentioned a moment ago, we reflect on what is most important in this short time, this very short time that we spend upon this earth together with others. And all of this in the light of the promises, I would say to us, all of this in light of the promises of Jesus, that this life is not all there is to life, that you and I have not been created only to experience this life. Part of what I've thought more and more over the years that I would just offer to you in this moment of your grief, of your loss, is the fact that we grieve, the fact that we struggle with loss means we have this capacity to love and be loved, and it's not by accident. To love like you do, to share life like we do, that's not an accident. To me, it's an indication of design, of a loving creator who has given us that capacity. And so the depth of the grief that we have maybe could be a reminder of the truth of what is yet to come in this life that God has given to us. I think that's a part of what Jesus wanted his disciples to know, his followers to know. And I'd like to read a few words from Jesus, God's son, Jesus. John's gospel records it this way. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. One of those disciples, Thomas, said back to Jesus, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus responded by saying, I am, this is Jesus talking, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. A little bit later in that same gospel, it's recorded Jesus saying these words, I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, who will be sent from the Father, will go to you, will come to you in my name, and will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. I think one of the most powerful portions of that reading, along with Jesus simply saying, with all the trouble that's about ready to come, and then by extension to us, whenever we're in trouble and whenever we're concerned about the end of life, Jesus saying, there is a way forward to experience life beyond this life. And it's not going to be anything like this world has to offer. He says, I give you a peace that is nothing like this world, because everything this world offers, the joy and the blessings of life and relationships and family and friends, everything comes to an end at some moment. And Jesus says, I offer you a peace that has nothing to do with this world, a peace that comes from a promise that we will continue to live even after we die. So I would just leave you with this. The one who said that was put to death, came back to life, lives and reigns to this day, And I believe it's though he is the one who calls us high to the mountain, that calls us forward to life in such a powerful way that death becomes the doorway to our experiencing all that God created us to experience. Not the end, but a doorway. A doorway through which we are set free to experience all that God has created us to experience. This is an ending. This is a transition. This is a loss, a moment of grief. But another biblical writer said, I want you to know the truth about what comes next so that you will grieve with hope. I hope you will have the hope that comes from believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. That Jesus, that God, that it sounds like Ellis and Layton taught others in Sunday school, that we might hear that truth today. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for family, friends, community, lives lived and shared, heritages, a heritage from life that will continue to live beyond us and certainly will live beyond Layton being here upon this earth. We've heard that testimony today, and it will continue to be heard in the conversations and the stories and the memories of this family and their friends. So Lord, we thank you for love and grace, for the hope of eternity you set in our hearts, and for the gift of faith in Jesus you offer to us that leads us to our heavenly home. In the grace-filled name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Turn to you in every moment of life, and especially in these moments, Lord, I pray that you would help this community that surrounds one another and is gathered in this place to remember and celebrate Layton's life. Lord, that they would know and experience be filled by your love. For we know, Lord, that you are the one that gives strength and hope and peace. And so it is to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, that we offer honor and glory, now and forever. And we say, into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend Leighton Burkhart, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Receive, O Lord, Leighton, according to your grace. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us even to this day, for the gift of life, for the gift of hope and peace in the time of death, that hope that leads us to life everlasting. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, the giver of life, the way, the truth, and the life, the one who knew our griefs, who died our death, rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. In his name we pray. Amen. Father, we now trust in you as we say to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, pour out that Spirit that we might know, receive, and share your love, your grace, your peace, knowing the hope that only you can give. In his name we pray.